Wow. Very profound time right now. Very profound. So we settle into this important video. I want to thank those who are watching. It's very helpful. And thank those who are not watching. It's also very helpful. Maybe too much pressure right now is too much for me. I don't need to be pushed too much right now, actually, because I'm dealing with something very difficult. I'm already being pushed by the Dharma Kings to help them turn the tide of irreverent culture towards a culture of reverence. But I'm hesitant to do anything like that in regards with myself, because I don't really deserve it. The teaching does. The practice does. The practice absolutely deserves reverence. The wild practice is the perennial apex of spiritual practice from all different religions, really, throughout history. Those really in the know understand that flattening evaluation is the only way to go. So I have been able to practice this and continuing to practice it, and practice it today quite extensively, and every day I practice it. And so I have a reverence towards this practice. It deserves it, 100% deserves it. Now, the trouble in this world right now, the terrible epidemic, is an epidemic of irreverence. And we know that. And yet we've tried to turn this around by being reverent towards politicians, okay? They don't know anything. They don't deserve your reverence. They deserve your love and respect as a spirit. But reverence, no, they're ignorant. The previous president loved the reverence. Okay, loved it, soaked it up. Said, yeah, everyone be reverent. I love it. Yeah, come on, more, 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 more. Oh, yeah, this is great. The one right now, I don't know. He seems to... we'll see. But in any case, don't be reverent to politicians. Only be reverent. Be reverent to right spiritual practice that liberates you from this concatenation, which means a chain of mental error of medication. Ad nauseum, ad infinitum. This is the dreadful swamp of sin, samsara, maya. And there's a way to get out of that. And I know the way, because the way is the right practice. And now Jesus, Longchenpa, Anandamayi Ma, Ramaharshi, Manjushri, Pabasava, Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, all of these have helped greatly in getting my attention to this practice, so we can start turning around this plague of irreverence. To be reverent to what is irreverent is itself irreverent. So being reverent to politicians is being very irreverent, very much so. Now, respect, yes. I mean, respect the president, respect the leaders, respect them and pray that they make the wise decisions, but in no way should you be reverent towards them. This just shows how far we've fallen. We have fallen so far that I don't know how it can be turned around, and I don't know if I'm up to the task of helping out, but I'm considering it. Longchenpa asked me to consider it, being a Dharma prince, which is someone who helps people with their reverence. They need to shift back to an attitude of reverence towards the sacred, towards eternal life, towards how to get the mind out of this concatenation, this hideous, 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 seemingly infinite regression, and then the mind is then clawing to find some niche in spirituality. This is horrible. There's a whole swamp of spirituality, right? A vast swamp. That's not eternal life. It's still plagued by all insecurities of hallucination. We're trying to create a new creation, be separate from God, be our own prime creator, and we're We're trying to do this by hallucinating the absence of reality. But hallucination is totally insecure. The next instant we can stop hallucination. It's not a creation. So we're trying to fixate the mind so hallucination becomes permanent, somehow automatically permanent, so we can feel like we've been able to have a new creation. But that's completely impossible to do. Completely impossible to do. So trying to secure a niche in this chain of mental error is absolute folly. And it still has all the insecurity of banking on a foundation of hallucination. Even if you're in some high realm of this dream, imagination, pretense of mind, you still have all the insecurity. You're just desperately trying not to fall into the lower realms, but you're very insecure that it could happen, right? It could happen and does happen. Does happen. Ultimately, you get either driven out or tricked out. Your own folly causes your downfall. Pride goes before a fall. So don't think that just because you can find some niche in a higher realm solves the problem at all. It doesn't. Only right practice solves it. Flattening out evaluation solves the problem. It brings to us to the peace of God. We become the peace of God. We not only abide in it, we are it. We are the peace of God. And that is still a condition, but it's the final condition, as Jesus puts it, the one illusion that dispels all other illusions, allows us to set them down and lose all interest in them. And then having done that, it's easy to let just one illusion just settle and gently set that down too. Ultimately, he says, but that's not our goal. Our goal is to be the peace of God, be the peace of God. And in order to do this, one has to be very wise and skillful in right practice, using the right practice to flatten evaluation. So our reverence to what we really are, which is eternal life, needs to be put on right practice. We should be very reverent towards that. So, you know, how to help this along, I don't know exactly. But I'm considering different possibilities. So that's the opening to the video. Very nice opening. Gives us plenty of food for thought. My back feels a little like right there, because I've been working out a lot. I'm really hitting it hard. Gently but consistently. And this is the way to hit this practice, the wild practice, flattening evaluations, gently but consistently. So you don't want to go so like in your exercise, you don't want to just, you know, be doing it, just overdo it to the point where next day you feel injured and you have to take a week off or 2 weeks off to heal up and all this stuff. Then you lose ground. You want to do just enough so the next morning you get up and you say, oh, I feel pretty good. I feel a little bit sore here and there, but overall I feel good. That's how I felt this morning. I didn't overdo it. And so I tried to do more today, but not overdo it. And I want that to be every day now. We're in this push towards May 22nd. So can this irreverent attitude of the world, which is just hideous, people have no idea how to be reverent anymore. I still go to church, Roman Catholic Church. I'm not a Catholic, but I go to church. My wife's Catholic. And because I have reverence for the institution and what it stands for and the history of it, even though what they're teaching is just, you know, really sad. You know, they've lost the narrative along the way throughout the ages, to say the least. But I still have reverence for it, you see. So I go there and I try to be reverent, and you know, it's very important to maintain a reverent attitude in every which way we can. Now I can admonish, but I still go and I'm still reverent, you know. Because it's not just the people now, it's the principle of the whole thing. It's the principle. I mean, it came from Jesus. Okay, it came. It's because of Jesus that there's this historic great reverence through the ages, right? An attitude of reverence, and the church certainly had that in days gone by, and now it's kind of just a formality, actually. It's a formality for most, and you know what it is. But we don't want to throw that out, so to speak. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. At least people feel like, you know, it's important to be on our best behavior and, you know, dress in a reverent way and act in a reverent way and all those things. They may seem superficial, but, you know, you got to crawl before you can walk. And it seems like a lot of people in the world are trying to run before they even know how to crawl. And what happens is they end up being reverent towards politicians and a socio-political, environmental agenda. And they have reverence towards that. They say, well, I have reverence towards the planet Earth. No, we have reverence towards what we are, which is eternal life or spirit. That's where the reverence belongs. Okay, and so they've displaced it all. The irreverent attitude towards what we really are. And they say, no, I'm not going to be reverent to that. So they fixate it on something else to avoid being reverent to where they should be. And that becomes this, you know, social agenda. And they're very fanatical and activist about that. Well, issues need to be dealt with. That's fine. But they're using it. They're using dogs and animals the same way, in order to avoid reverence towards the sacred, towards eternal life, towards the peace of God, towards the Dharma kings. In order to avoid that, they're trying to fixate reverence on some dog. It's an avoidance technique. Some politician, some dog, right? It's all the same, some world. It's a defense mechanism to avoid genuine reverence, so they can continue arrogantly to believe that this is a new creation. And of course, some try to give God credit for it, say, yeah, God, you're responsible for hallucinating the absence of God, you know. You're responsible for this new creation. No. Creation is still present, all value, everywhere, always. It's present right here, everywhere. It's just that we're hallucinating the absence of it, and then trying to fixate that hallucination. So, I'm just a lowly blue-collar laborer type, don't have any money at all. And really, so people don't feel any sense of reverence towards me at all. They, you know, I'm just nobody in the pecking order, right? Nobody. But I'm aware of the truly effective practice that leads to eternal life, and I've been practicing it for quite some time, and I'm very skilled at it, and I seem to be a darling of the Dharma kings because of this, because I placed practice first. I'm reverent towards practice. That's what they want. That's what they're looking for. That's why Longchenpa came to me and said, hey, I want, you know, we want you. Why? I said, why? I'm nobody in the world. He says, but you're very reverent towards practicing, and so you continually refine it and get better and better and better and better. It's all you care about. And he says, that's what we love. That's what is necessary. So, exactly, you know, what to do, I'm not sure. But there has to be some shift. We have to shift, and we have to start being reverent. And I feel uncomfortable with the laissez-faire, you know, equality thing in the world. Everybody treats everybody like an average Joe or Jane, you know. It's just, I mean, that's become the new religion, irreverence. We should be reverent all the time. If we're not, what are we paying attention to? We must have our attention off of what deserves reverence. And why are we doing that? Now, does a guru deserve reverence? Well, the Dharma kings do, you could say, because they're the ones who are truly in service to us through helping us, guide us towards the right practice. Now, if they have wanted someone to be a spokesman for them, then maybe some degree of reverence is due by association with right practicing, Not towards me or anyone in particular. Practicing is higher than any guru because it's what brings us to recognize that we are the peace of God. Okay. That's even beyond the function, quote, of a guru. So that's why I say we're the guru of our own practice. So certainly reverence towards yourself is important because you deserve it and you're the one who has to do the practicing. So if you have reverence towards someone who is advocating this practice, by extension, you're having reverence for yourself. You need to have reverence for yourself so that you feel you deserve to succeed at this practice. You see? So I have this reverence towards myself because I know I'm doing right. I'm focused on what actually works, and this is giving compassion and help to everyone. So each one of us has to have this reverence towards ourselves, a genuine reverence enough so that we actually practice. That means you're saying, I deserve eternal life because that's how God created me. And that hasn't changed one bit. And that's worthy of reverence. The creations of God are worthy of reverence. So ultimately, it's the irreverent attitude that we have towards ourselves that's the problem. And we need to turn that around and we need to start practicing. So you could start by having some reverence for those who are experts in practicing because they're showcasing how to have reverence for yourself. So as long as we have this clear that this is what's going on, that's a possibility. But you must hold your head up high and have the right tone in your life. Like I've tried to do. I've always thought very highly of myself, meaning I have great reverence for my willingness to practice. And that's where the reverence should be. Doing what works is compassion for others, showing them what works. This works. This is what we need to do. So in that vein, something could happen, could take place, helpful. Starts out with reverence towards those who know, who have been practicing the right way, who have reverence for their own practicing, for practicing right. Start out there, and then gradually you begin to develop momentum of reverence for your own, for yourself, and for your own practicing. Not a narcissistic, ego-driven kind of adulation of yourself, but a reverence for yourself. I mean, this practicing is the most important thing in the world for me. Nothing is even close. Nothing even registers in relation to this at all. I don't compare it with anything. It's incomparably important. That's why I do it every day. As you can see, the evidence is here. And reverence is a different feeling. It's not like approval or thanks or stuff like that. No, it's different. It's like the Tibetans have so much reverence for their gurus and the lamas and the tradition. The overall tradition of what works, the overall focus of what works, the Dharma kings. We're very ecumenical here because anyone of any religion can do this practice, of any background or no religion at all. Anyone can do this practice. And anyone can have reverence for their capacity to practice in this way. So the tradition of success in this is what we should have reverence to, and the Dharma kings represent the tradition of successfully practicing unto the peace of God and eternal life. So that's why it's important to feel that we're part of this this larger scene that we need to have reverence for. All different religions in history, in different times and places, have had representatives who have practiced successfully. And so we need not try to say which religion is better, who's better in this way or that. We just say, you know, this practice is the best practice, plain and simple. Flattening evaluation is what has to happen. It's what has to happen. And making a transition into the peace of God has to happen. Has to happen. Now, you could always put variations in. But just like the keyboard on a piano is the keyboard on a piano. It is what it is. I mean, whatever you play on it, it's still the keyboard. Right? It's still the scales. So flattening evaluation, however you want to talk about it, it's still the same. It's still the same. It has to be done. And understanding the principles of it is what is key. Really, really having a feel and clarity about the overall principles of it is what is absolutely key. And again, no religion gets in the way of this, okay? It doesn't get in the way. No, nothing gets in the way of it. If you want to get it, nothing will get in the way of it. You will be able to do it and experience and then manage your success and go forward with it. But you must have reverence for yourself. And when you have that, you treat your life very differently. Your life doesn't, you know, you stop being so profane in your life. So much profane attitude in the world. I'm reading comments surfer websites. I mean, surfers tend to be very profane. It's really sad. I don't know why. There's a few that are not. But most are you know, very profane. I said, you know, that's not good. That's not right. They don't respect themselves. Maybe because the ocean beats them up so bad, they don't respect themselves, you know? And having been a surfer, I can say that's it. You know, I understand. They're bitter. One, it's hard to find good waves. Two, when you find good waves, there's too many people out surfing them and you don't get anything. Three, most people don't have the opportunity to go surfing very much, so they're out of shape and they can't, even when they find good waves, they can't surf them very good. And four, surfing is very difficult and usually the ocean wins. So, you know, you get all that stacked on top of you and you're not going to be a very happy camper. And they're not. They're bitter. But it's a lot easier to surf the inner wave of practicing. You know, carve up your practicing the way John carves up, you know, Margaret River. You know, score like, you know, 9.5, 9.7, 9.8, almost perfect. Every wave he gets is almost a perfect score. You can carve up your practicing that way and you will stop being bitter. You won't be a bitter, lonely, bitter surfer boy anymore or surfer girl, you know. It's a very profane culture. You know, so is skateboarding, you know, so some of this stuff is just like, wow. Well, because they take a lot of nasty falls and hurt themselves and, you know, it hurts and it's painful and it's not easy and, you know, they might try a trick a thousand times and fall so many times and hurt themselves and they finally land it and they think, oh, I should be able to do it like in these skate videos. Well, what they don't know is like, you know, Jason Park is like following a 200 times before he finally hits the trick and all you see in the video is him just skating and landing this trick and it's like, ah, it's easy, you know. Well, he fell 200 times before he landed it. So you go out and you try to do that, and you just kill yourself, you know. You're beat up and bruised and angry, and you know, life's not fair. You know, how come I'm so untalented? How come Jason Park can land it and easy and I can't? Now, fortunately, Brett Novak, the skate videographer, put in outtakes and is shown in his videos outtakes, which is very much appreciated, because then you start to see what's really going on behind the scenes, and it puts context into it. So I really appreciate that, and you know, it takes a lot of pressure off people to see that and say, wow, that isn't so easy. So I have a lot of videos, thousands, where you see, you know, I'm struggling. It's not so easy. Okay, so it's not like you just do it like that. That's nonsense. And someone like John Florence has been serving since he's 2 years old, I think. I think his mom put him on a board when he was like just an infant or something. And you know, he was in contests when he was 5 years old, I believe, and serving pipeline a contest at 13, 13. I mean, he's been on a board mo in the ocean more than most of us, you know, have just been walking around. So his life has been spent on the ocean surfing. So I don't know, what is he now, 24 or something? So he's had like 20 years, or more than 20 years of just full-on, continuous, super intense surfing, being mentored by the best surfers in the world. So you see him, you know, just on a next higher level right now. That just, you know, Kelly Slater just said, you know, this performance at Margaret River will always be talked about in the history of surfing. It was that great. It's the new, you know, he's showing us this new era, this something we've never seen before, really. And he was very eloquent, and I saw it all, and I said, yeah, that this is accurate. I mean, it was really cool to see that. But that didn't happen just easily. He's absolutely worked at it like nobody's business, and taken a lot of bumps and bruises along the way, almost getting drowned a number of times, you know, in sharks and you name it. I mean, he has paid the price to be that good. So you're going to pay a price to be really good at practicing, but it's a price worth paying. It's a price worth paying, and there needs to be this reverence. Your attitude of reverence is the most important ally you have. And if you try to live a profane life, you're going to fail at it. You know, the ocean's going to win. It's going to win. You have to respect the ocean. You have to, if you're a surfer, you have to respect the ocean enough to study it, enough to really do your homework, enough to be really fit, enough to understand, you know, hey, stay out of trouble, make wise decisions, and you know, the whole ball of wax. You just can't go out there and say, hey, you know, I'm the boss of the ocean, and let me show the ocean who's boss. You're gonna get stomped. And I've been through that. Okay, it was too difficult for me. All the factors were against me. I didn't go often enough. Didn't have the money for shape, to have board shape, really. And just, you know, wasn't in good enough shape. Couldn't not good enough waves, really. Just the whole ball of wax. Everything was against me. But in our practicing, we can do this every day right where we are. So there's no excuses. You could do this while practice, at work, driving, all the time, actually. That's what I do. It's easy. Whatever arises, today I was practicing, whatever arose, I would say, wow, I already have perfect medicine from this road. I already have perfect medicine from this car. I already have perfect medicine from this person. I already have perfect medicine from this sign. You know, I already have perfect medicine from this building. And so everything that came to my mind, I saw during the day I practice. Wow, I already have perfect medicine from this paint. Wow. I already have perfect medicine from these trees. Wow. And then I was just able to, in your mind, you're able to just come up with all these different examples. Whatever pops in your mind, just say, oh, I already have perfect medicine from this scenario. Let's see, you start daydreaming some scenario. You just say, oh, I already have perfect scenario, perfect medicine from this scenario. And then you'll find it just dissolves. Your interest in it dissolves like this. So this is advanced wow practice. I'm doing very advanced wow practice, and this is like just carving up this practice beautifully, just surfing it beautifully. So you know, it's great to see these top surfers. There's a lot of quotes now, articles about the top surfers in the world talking about John Florence's performance at Margaret River in Western Australia, and they're all so complimentary. You know, they're just gushing about it. And it shows respect and reverence for the sport. You know, they have reverence for the sport of surfing. So this is coming out. And Florence represents, he has reverence for the sport of surfing too. And so they're recognizing this. They're saying, look where his reverence for the sport has taken him. We want to have that too. And we want youngsters coming up to have this, to surf in this level, to have this level of reverence. You know, they're not bitter or trying to cut him down or be profane or everything. They're saying, yeah, they're cheering him on, saying, thank you, this is awesome. This shows great reverence for the sport of surfing. And again, we want our contemporaries and especially the younger generation to look at this and say, yeah, we want to be like John John. We want to surf like John John. Well, guess what? That takes a lot of reverence. He's a very humble type of guy. You know, he's not this really profane. I mean, he's a young person, so there's some profane because that's the way culture is. But you can tell that he's got reverence in him for what he's doing. Or else it'd be pretty difficult to be as good as he is if he didn't really, really have a sense of reverence about it. So it's very important to have that in order to be very successful, especially at reaching the peace of God, being the peace of God, which is the ultimate accomplishment here. It's the ultimate accomplishment. The other accomplishments really don't mean anything except for the reverence you bring to them. And if you're really reverent towards something, which really reverence towards yourself, this ultimately will help you, and you'll be able to transfer this over to spiritual practice. Like in a previous life, I was very reverent towards music. Tremendous reverence. I was completely dedicated to it. And I was like one of the main torchbearers for music in the world. And so I brought this sense of reverence with me, which means tremendous dedication, tremendous focus, believing it's so important and compassionate, it's going to help people like this. I brought that, and this was able to be transferred over to connecting with this great spiritual practice and the goal of the peace of God. And in music, I had so much reverence for it. I practiced so much. I just dedicated all my attention to it. So I had the ability to dedicate all attention to one central focus. And apply all this practice to it, to be a virtuoso, to be top of your field in all these different ways that you have to be. And so I transferred all that over to the spiritual path. So if you are reverent towards something, good. Start transferring that over now to the spiritual path, the right spiritual practice. And if you're not reverent at all, start becoming reverent. And if you can't do it to the spiritual path directly, then do it to something that's really outstanding. But let it be something that's artistic, that's abstract, that's out of the political realm, that's out of the hustle and bustle of the world, something that lifts your spirit out of the world, okay? It really has to be something that helps you feel lift your spirit out of the world and is not stuck in the swamp, okay. So they say comments are like, you know, John John Florence surfing at Margaret River. It was like just beautiful artistry, wave artistry, and it was beautiful to watch. It's just like, wow, the arcs and the spray and the flow, and it's just like, it was beautiful to watch. It's holy cow. So it's pretty abstract, right? And then the wave is broken and it's all gone. Like, what happened to it? But it was like a moment in time where there was some reverence was present, and something elevated, kind of the next level, so to speak, was there. But really, our goal is reverence towards spiritual path, the right practice, actually. Spiritual path means right practice. It doesn't mean spirituality. It doesn't mean bells and beads and tassels and postures and perfumes and crystals and, you know, all this New Age stuff. It doesn't mean that. It means right practice. And that used to be done in the world. I mean, Tibetan Buddhism is the best example. We have really in more modern times, because they've been isolated from the world, they've kept it going so well. But, you know, they really had a lot of success, and they have tremendous reverence for practice. At least they have had. You know, who knows how that'll play out going forward in this very irreverent world right now. And in times even further back, Christianity certainly had tremendous amount of reverence for practice. And going back even further, Buddhism. Okay, and you go back even further, Judaism, right? And going back even further, Vedic culture, Hindu Vedic culture. All right, so, and then Islam also had tremendous reverence for practice, right? In various ways. And you name any, you know, any tradition, and the reverence for right practice is there. The reverence for right practice is there. But it tends to get lost as we struggle trying to find some sense of security. We keep falling back into materialism. We take our eye off the prize, and this is what happens here. So you have to put your eye back on the prize. And how do you do that is the question. I'm not entirely sure. I'm just floating ideas and looking at them and saying, is this possible? This or this, this. So we'll see. We'll see. I'm trying to, ideas are coming up and say maybe we can do this, maybe we can do that, but we've got to shift gears. We have to shift gears. What we're doing right now isn't working in the world. It's not working at all. And I believe that most people feel that they're so profane that they don't deserve, you know, that they're fundamentally profane at this point. And at that point, you know, they say, what the heck, I might as well just go all in and just be totally profane. You know, there's no point in even trying. So you reach that stage of no point in even trying, and it's a bad scene. Now, I had this jacket in church, and it was cold. We went outside. It was Palm Sunday, so we went outside for the palm procession, to go inside the church. And so I zipped my jacket all the way up to the top. And then I said, okay, well, maybe that's a little too high. Let me unzip it. I started to unzip it. Stuck. I said, uh-oh, this jacket, the inner flap is made out of, like, it's almost like parachute cloth material, and it gets caught in the zipper every time. If you zip it up too far, it gets stuck in the zipper. So I started struggling with it during this outdoor reading that we were having, ceremony, and I couldn't seem to get it, and ultimately I kind of finally looked at it and said, oh my gosh, I'm in trouble. It was absolutely stuck in the zipper, worse than you can imagine, and I couldn't budge the zipper in either direction. I said, uh-oh. So what am I thinking? I'm thinking, how can I get this jacket off of me? It's zipped up, you know, all the way up my neck like this. And I said, I'm not sure I can get this jacket off of me, to tell you the truth. So got home, and I said, well, here goes nothing. It's going to be close. And it was very close. It was very, very tight on my head. But I was able to get it off, get the jacket off of me. So the world is stuck like that stuck zipper. Really badly stuck. Really, really badly stuck. Can we get that jacket off of us, of profane culture? Well, it's going to be tight. It's going to be a real tight fit. I believe we can get it off, but it's going to be a very tight fit. And as far as profane culture goes, it's going to collapse. All right, it's going to collapse. Profane culture always collapses, and profane culture is very boring culture, very, very boring, exceedingly boring. And it's kind of like drug culture, where you have to take more and more drugs to get the same effect. And profane culture becomes more and more profane, to try and get whatever effect they're after, you know. Some sense of security, like, I don't care if I'm insecure. I don't care if I'm insecure. You know, I can get used to it. I'm tough. Something like that. So it collapses, and the collapse is boring too. It's all boring. So I'm not going to pay any attention to the collapse of profane culture. It's not interesting. It's extremely boring. I don't care how it collapses. Whichever way it collapses, it's a boring collapse. Period. The collapse of boringness is always boring also. Keep that in mind. So we don't really need to pay attention to this profane culture, where it goes. You know, we need to make the turnaround with ourselves. And wherever this profane culture wanders off to, it's a boring wander. It's an aimless, boring wander. And how it eventually sinks into the desert, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how it collapses. It doesn't make any difference. Don't pay any attention to it. So, you know, here we have some parameters that's worth, you know, listening to and really considering. And I'm trying to get in better and better shape. I keep working at it, and it's just for feeling like, can I not be crushed, you know, by profane culture as part of it? Can I be on my toes? Can I feel like I have a strong core? I have a ability to sit for a long time. There's a sense of, you know, there's some strength and some energy and focus here. You know, I want to keep myself from just falling into sort of a, you know, overly negligent attitude, like, what the heck, you know, there's no hope. I want to project a feeling of, yes we can do it, yes we can, you know, bounce in your step, clap of the hands, you say, yes we can. So the Dharma Kings want me to work out. They want me to be in good shape. They told me, you know, if you get in good shape, and then, you know, maybe you can help us out. Not maybe, you can help us out. So I'm doing that. I'm running on a, you know, trampoline and swinging some weights, kind of simulating golf swing with some weight, like a weighted tube, and doing push-ups and doing Bosu ball, core work on a Bosu ball, doing balance work and walking and just a whole bunch of different kinds of stuff. So I'm very solid in that. My nutrition, I'm staying very solid with it. You know, the kale smoothies, you know, once or twice a day, mostly liquid diet with some really healthy stuff in it. Continuing with that. Continuing with the WOW practice. So great nutrition, great workouts, great spiritual practice, and I'm doing all of that stuff. Continuing on with that, and I feel pretty good. Overall, my knee actually feels a little better, believe it or not. The trampoline work is helping it. So I'm building up strength in my knee, and with that, and not road running. I tried road running. The pounding just hurt the knee too much. So I started walking instead. So I'm walking. That's going pretty well. And I noticed I had a hard time walking in exactly a straight line. I kind of wobble a little bit this way, wobble a little bit that way. I said, wow, I've got to get more stable with my walking. And I was trying all different strides and all different, there's ways to exercise while walking, doing all sorts of different types of walking, actually. You know, I noticed that. It's been pretty interesting. It's pretty fun. So I did many, many, many different types of walking. It's a nice little workout. But I'm being gentle about it all. I'm not trying to overdo anything. I'm just saying, hey, gently exercise strongly. Okay, gently exercise strongly. Gently practice spiritual practice strongly. Gently have great nutrition strongly. In other words, don't starve yourself. That doesn't work too well, because there's a bounce back. You reach a real low point, and then you just suddenly feel desperate, and you say, man, this is not working for me. And then you gain it all back. It's very tough to keep it off, isn't it? So I'm still Overweight. A little bit, yeah. And hopefully tomorrow I'll be a little better and just kind of ease it back down to more of an ideal weight. So, but this has to do with reverence for myself, is I'm trying to keep myself healthy, vital, and so I can practice better and better and better and better. That's the aim. That's the aim. So if you really care, have reverence for what you're doing, you want to be the best that you can be at it. Without being absurd in just emphasizing like nutrition and then not practicing. Say, well, look, I'm so great at nutrition, you know, that's reverence for myself. Well, it's crawling, okay? It's trending, but it's still a crawl. So the root has to be there. The practice has to be there. And just because you're doing great nutrition doesn't mean you're doing great practice. I was doing great practice long before I paid any attention to nutrition or fitness or any of that stuff. I just felt it would help me going forward at this point. That's what the Dharma Kings has suggested to me. It would be helpful. I was talking to someone. I saw someone today, an acquaintance of mine, friend of mine, you might say, and I've been noticing him recently. He looks dazed and confused and tired. He didn't look right. The smile's gone from his face. Something's wrong, I knew. So I had a chance to speak, you know, chat with him today, and I said, hey, you know, how you doing? He said, well, I'm, you know, And I said, you look weak. And he's like, kind of, like, what? I look weak? I said, well, I said, you know, people in this world, it's amazing how they size one another up. It's a very animalistic thing. Animals are super great at body language, aren't they? And so they know, that's why, you know, dogs and packs get along. The body language of the alpha dog, you know, is such that the other ones see it and they say, wow, okay, this one's really strong and confident. I better back off of it. They're very keen on that. And actually, we are too. We're actually quite astute at being able to pick up all the signs of someone. How are they doing? And now I found, for one, as you get older, people start trying to push you around. Younger generation starts trying to push you around. They really do. And those who are more fit and stronger, etc., of your own age group starts to push you down. You start getting stepped on. And you can feel the psychological pressure on yourself when you're tired, when you're weak. And it's just like you feel like you just can't get up. It's you're being like stepped on and walked on under boot into the grave. It's very insidious, actually. And so realizing that, I said, wow, that's probably not going to be helpful if I'm going to try to help out the world and help people have reverence, return to a reverent attitude. I don't want to give off the vibe like I'm somebody that they can walk over, you know? That's not helpful for them. So that's part of the reason I've gotten in shape and everything, is so people can look at me and say, you know, he's not some walkover, you know? So I better take that out of my mind. That's helpful. I noticed something in church yesterday. I mean, I'm feeling good. I'm in better shape, you know. Now I'm really getting better and better and better, and I look real good. I felt real good. I felt real strong and agile and everything. And as I was leaving church, some of these elder men there, and some of the women, the you know power queen bees, they I passed them and they smiled at me. I just kind of looked at them, smiled. They smiled at me. And that's the first time that's ever really happened like that. First time. And I was very shocked by it. And some of these men were very dignified. I mean, you know, like, and yet, they must have looked at me and says, "Hey, you know, here's an alpha male, you know." And so, mutual respect. You know, they're saying, another alpha male saying, "Mutual respect. I see that you're very, you know, got it together. You know, you're not a pushover at all. Not a pushover in any way." So I was quite surprised. I didn't quite understand what was happening. But I better, you know, start getting more used to it. It means that my vibe that I'm giving off is way more confident. I'm giving off a very confident vibe, and you know, they just kind of a nod. And it's like, I see it. You know, I see it. Okay. And that's body language. It's just a slight, subtle nod. Yeah, I see that you're not no pushover. That's for sure. And you know, that's okay. That's okay. Okay. Respect, right? Respect for that. So I told this young man, he was a very young man, he's 21 or something, he's very young. I said, look, this is what happens, right? And he said, yeah, I know, I'm very aware of that. I said, good. I said, look, you cannot allow yourself to get run down as you're looking. I said, hold on. Okay, 1 second here. I can just put this on mute. Okay. Yes, hon, I'm taping right now. How's it going? Okay. Yeah, I'm home taping right now. Mm-hmm. We'll see you for what? Wait, 8 o'clock? Okay, fine, hon. Very good. Have a good time. Walk. Okay, bye. Take care. Bye. Okay, bye. So I told him, you can't let yourself, your body, I said, your body language is no good. I got to tell you that. I said, you look weak. And he kind of like, weak. And he says, I'm tired. I'm really tired. I says, yeah, it shows. It really shows. He says, you can't go around that way because people will start stepping on you and you'll find yourself in the bottom of the barrel. It's kind of like a dog-eat-dog world, actually, this world, isn't it? And he says, yeah, I know. That's very true. I said, hey, you know, I said, the most important thing is your core. You got to work on your core because when your core is really strong, even when you're tired, you'll carry yourself in such a way that people say, well, you know, he's just tired, but he's still strong. You know, there's a strong presence here. And he said, of course, okay. He listened to it. He said, yeah, okay, yeah, that's good advice. You know, and he's like more working on his arms. See, the problem, people work on their arms. They want to look confident and strong. They like do all these weight lifts for their arms, so the arms get real bulky and strong. Like, but their core isn't so strong, and they don't have this overall stability strength. The stability muscles aren't strong. And it's just a show. You know, like, oh, look at these biceps or something. It's easy. Anybody can do, you know, curls. I mean, you start doing curls every day, and before you know it, you got these big biceps. Anybody can do that. That's a cheap thing, you know. It's like putting on makeup. Okay, any woman can put on makeup and look beautiful, okay? And look confident. I mean, women look beautiful for their sense of confidence. Because everyone tends to respect a beautiful woman in this world, right? They say, look how attractive and beautiful I am. For confidence. Well, you know, that's not going to get you very far, okay? And so I said, this is the core work. It's the core work that you need to do. Because so you'll feel confident. When your core is strong, you yourself feel confident in yourself, even when you're tired. And then that is projected to others. And that's what I'm experiencing. My core is getting better and better and better and better. I felt my side yesterday and like, my gosh, I said, I was like, what? What is this? Well, that's, you know, core strength that I've been working on now for quite some time. Year and a half. And it's getting better. And I say, wow. So I just feel, you know, overall more confident because of the core strength. And that is projected. So, but that's hard work, you know. That most people avoid that. They say, no, let me just give me the weight and I'll do some. I always did that in my life. If I ever worked out, you do the barbells or the dumbbell or whatever, and you know, just try to, you know, get some, look like your, you know, arms are strong. But you still don't feel very confident after that. You say, oh, what the heck? What's the use? It doesn't work. Well, because that's not we're not doing the right practice. We should be doing the core work, and we should be engaging our core in everything we're doing. For instance, like doing push-ups. Now I'm able to actually do push-ups now. Before, I couldn't even do one, not even close, not even close. Now I'm able to do real push-ups, legit, engaging my core, I was able to do 40 gas station push-ups today, rapidly. One after the first time, I think I've done 40, boom, boom, just one after another without slowing down hardly at all. And I kept my core engaged and my breathing. I did my breathing right. Before, I wasn't paying attention to my breathing. But now I realized exhale before five, right at five, fifth push-up, exhale, and then and quickly gasp another breath for the sixth one, and then exhale at 10 and inhale for the 11th. So every five push-ups, it's quick exhale and quick inhale for the oxygen. And before, I was holding my breath too long and then letting it out and then taking it again, and my whole breathing wasn't proper, actually. So when exercising, you should be aware of your core, how you're engaging your core muscles. They should be engaged in whatever exercise you do. It should be tensed up, and your breathing should be in sync. You should be aware of your breathing as you're doing the exercise. And I didn't used to do either of those until just recently. Like a month ago, engage your core. I realized what it meant, and it's made a huge difference. And then breathing also, I never paid attention. I just recently, a couple of weeks ago, I suddenly kind of be, hey, wait a minute. You know, I hold my breath there, then out here, then hold it here. And that correlated with singing. I suddenly realized how to breathe properly for singing too, which I never knew how to do. So these are helpful. But a lot of people use this information to have reverence for higher realms, power, prestige, all that stuff, instead of the peace of God, which is just wrong use of all this information. Okay, so I don't like to get too technical about this stuff, and I myself don't make it too technical, because people get obsessed by all this stuff because they're trying to become, you know, so confident that they become a great queen or a great king in the higher realms and in the God realms, you know, and the realms of the gods and goddesses. And as Sri Sri Anandamayi said, she represented eternal life here, one of the representatives of eternal life. She said, I found myself in this huge array of all these gods and goddesses of every variety and such, and yet, honestly, she says, I have to tell you, I was above them all. I was above them all. Okay, meaning that what we really, eternal life, is absolutely above all the gods and goddesses, that entire realm, which is the realm of make-believe, actually. You know, it's a realm of trying to stabilize hallucination. It's just the way that we've set it up is we think that someone has to be successful, and we have to have some belief that we can successfully do this. So we've dreamed up these various realms, of the lowest hellish realms and the highest god and goddess realms, just so we can have this belief that there's some stratification, meaning there's some progress being made, or is possible, right? And we look at these higher realms saying, oh yeah, you see that there, that's where stabilization is. But down here in hell, we don't have the stabilization. So, but it's all just one dream. There's no real layers or levels to the dream at all. So she was letting us know this fact. So to use, you know, a lot of people in the world are using nutrition and fitness and all this stuff just to try and reach that higher, you know, God and goddess realm, and thinking that's it. That's not our goal at all. That's not the goal of the spiritual path, okay? Not at all. So we don't want to, and because that path in itself doesn't work, they become too obsessed with it. But we're not fools. We're not going to be negligent to say that having some confidence in these ways can't be helpful on the spiritual path. Sure. Sure it can. You don't want to have everybody disrespect. You don't want to project an aura of a loser, of a pushover loser, and someone who's not confident, and someone who really is doesn't know what they're doing. And particularly on this, the WOW path is again, it's the... You go through like a mini death when you practice this, a death of expectations, mini death of identity, so to speak, expectation-based identity. You go through a mini death, and when you do that, you go through this period of just like you're not really sure who you are, or what you are, or what you're going to be doing. So you seem very unconfident in yourself. And you have to let that, you're in shock is what happens. So when you're in shock, you project a lack of confidence. So you have to let that wear off, okay, through inaction, patient inaction. Don't try to do anything until the shock wears off, and it will. And then you can start getting back in the flow. But at first, you're kind of like a little shaky, actually. A little shaky. So, because of this, it's important, I found it's important to be in good condition so that you still can project some confidence out to the world. Otherwise, people kind of look at it and say, huh, he looks like, you know, maybe he was on drugs or something, or he's lacking confidence in himself. He's kind of like, you know, heads down, kind of like, wow, you know, maybe he's got mental problems, or maybe, and so they start projecting doubt upon you, you see. So to be able to do this practice really effectively, it helps. It helps. If you have to go out in public, especially, I try to stay out of public as much as possible. So I'm able to do very intense practicing, and then I get really, you know, the shock, and I'm recovering from it. I just try to hang out in my room and don't be around anybody, because they'll start projecting doubt upon me. But if I have to go out in public, then I dress nice, I'm fit, I try, you know, I have this sort of this overall confident aura about myself, like, I can handle myself. The way that I walk, the way that you walk is important. So this stuff is important. It's some of the finer points. But if you can still project some confidence in the world, even though you're recovering from the shock of this practice, then it goes much smoother for you. You don't lose confidence. You don't start doubting in yourself. Okay? I went to church after an intense practice, and you know, I was able to hold my confidence in church. It's not easy. So that's why I'm seeing that there is some value to this nutrition and fitness. There is some value to it, some helpfulness to it, if we understand it's not an end in itself. So walking is important, and I'm working on that, walking. How do you walk in such a way as to project confidence? That's important. And of course, those who want to be gods and goddesses, they already know that. So, you know, that's because that's all they focus on, is to project confidence. thinking that that'll get them the higher realm, and it will. But they'll fall again, too, into the hellish realms. It's not a secure place at all. So, you know, but they do know that. And they do work on their fitness and their nutrition and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, how to walk and project confidence. Yeah, but it's a superficial confidence they have. It doesn't, you know, they're not, when they go collapse into the hellish realms, they're going to lose that confidence. They're not going to have it. And then it's a sad picture to see, I'll tell you that. It most certainly is. I mean, I've been through it. And coming back to this world from the higher realms, and then losing my health and losing my confidence. My confidence absolutely collapsed. I used to be super confident. Totally collapsed my confidence. Well, almost totally. I was completely bewildered of what happened, you know. Where to go, you know. But I still had confidence and enough reverence for myself through my previous life of all the effort I made, that I said, I can still be determined, and I can still practice every day, and I can still, you know, believe that this will work. But other than that, I had no confidence at all. It's horrible. Couldn't get it. So having been through it, I know it's terrible. So keep your spiritual practice is what's important. But the other stuff does help your spiritual practice. I'm seeing that now. And if you're eating right, eating real good, it's like a placebo effect. You say, you know, I feel my health is great. So for me, people ask, oh, you should go to the doctor, get checked out, blah, blah, blah. I said, why? I mean, what can I change in my life to make it better? Nothing. I'm doing everything just right in terms of my health. So if there's some affliction, why should I care about it or worry about it at this point? Let God take care of that. Let my practice take care of it. So if they say, well, you know, why throw doubt on yourself? If you're doing nutrition really good and you understand, you know, how to do it right, don't eat big meals. Undereat, don't eat big meals. Those are two of the most important ones. Make sure you get your vegetables, your nuts, your seeds, your grains, your fruits, your vegetables. Try to make them organic if possible. Drink eat or drink liquid diet smoothies really great. It helps you, the body absorb it better. And small amounts during the day instead of three huge meals during the day is really important. I do all that stuff right. So for me, I just feel like, you know, I don't even think about my body's health. I don't think about the body's health, really. I really don't. Why worry about it? Where most people, they think about their health, a lot of people, all the time. It's all they ever think about. What's that? I felt something there. What's that? Because they know that they haven't done it right, and they've abused their body, and it's falling apart. So yeah, if your house is falling apart, you're going to be paranoid. Like, what was that? I heard something there. Uh-oh, maybe that's happening now. Me, I don't have that. I just assume, very powerfully assume, it's like everything's like golden. It's great. My health's great. So, you know, everything is gonna run fine. So don't worry about it. Don't think about it. I have to be careful with my knee. That's just a practical thing. But I say, well, you know, I just be a little cautious with it, and that's fine. Get some strength back in it. I don't know if it'll recover entirely. There may be some issue there, but at least it's preventing me from wasting time on too much athleticism. I was straying in that direction. So this knee cured me of that, which is great. I always thank that knee. Thank you, knee. You've done a great job to help me and everyone else out by getting tweaked somehow and preventing me from going on this athletic jag, which I was virtually capable of doing, you know, is really something. I needed to back away from that. So great job, knee. So, and I advise looking presentable, very presentable, like a confident person in the world, someone who's capable of handling their stuff in the world, which I really can't. I don't really pay any attention to the world and handling stuff in the world at all. But you don't want to look like the world is like crushing you. People tend to pile on or pity you or doubt, you know, they doubt you, like, wow, that doesn't look good, you know, like that. You see someone who's really fallen apart and you just look at them and say, wow. That's not good. They're something wrong there, you know. And so people can misdiagnose you when you're doing this practice. They misdiagnose you because you're intentionally putting yourself through the shock of going beyond your expectations and flattening out evaluation. It creates an inner shock in your mind. And so for a while, you feel kind of flat in your confidence. Your confidence gets flattened too. Okay, this does temporarily flatten your confidence. But what happens is, once you recover from that shock, the confidence is better than ever. That's what happens here. So it's a very positive spiral. But you pay the price, you carry the cross of temporarily flattening your confidence, like Jesus falling under the ground on the way to the cross. That means your confidence has just been flattened temporarily. And so people can misdiagnose you and say, oh wow, you know, they're what's wrong with them? They're falling apart. It must be something wrong. No, the people ask me, are you okay? I say, yeah, I feel great. You sure? Yeah, I feel too. So they're kind of like, they misdiagnose you. They don't understand. In this profane culture we have, they don't understand. That's part of the problems. The more profane the culture is, the more difficult it becomes to practice spiritually successfully. In other times and places, people would understand this. And they would know that's a yogin or something. So they'd say, oh, you know, he's going through this yoga practice and he goes through these cycles of, you know, where he'll feel shocked for a while. And they have a reverence for that. And they say, you know, and they, oh, let me make sure I understand. Thank you for practicing. It's helping all of us. And let me help you out here. Let me help you out here. That's the culture. You know, let me give you whatever help you need. I'll do it for you. Don't worry. Like, that's the way reverent cultures are. They know the yogins are the highest members of their dharmic society, along other than the gurus and the dharma kings, and so they're treated like gold, rightfully so, because they're setting example and making it easier for everybody else. That's why they're treated like gold, and it's understood that meditation puts you in these, flattens your worldly confidence out in temporarily, so they're given all the respect for that, because it's difficult. Not in this culture, they think that there's something wrong with you. So indeed, the profane culture really heads towards collapse very severely. And it's and as such, everyone has avoided this practice. And so it's frustrating for me, because I see so many quote-unquote spiritual teachers who are really straying into spirituality, because they just don't have the nerve to come out and say what needs to be said. And it's too bad. So, I'm somewhat, rare case, because in my previous life I was very outspoken and faced the wrath of, I spoke up for a whole continent, whole world culture, and so I was like a figurehead, and I got a lot of backlash. A lot of people ignored me, a lot of people didn't like me, they criticized me a lot. So I'm accustomed to speaking up, in a storm of opposition, and still speaking my mind. I didn't back down. Some people really respected this, and other people really criticized it. It says, how come he doesn't compromise more, like that? Compromise. I mean, either you have reverence or you don't. I mean, we're not looking for some middle ground between profanity and reverence, are we? I mean, what is that? How can that be our goal? We're not looking for some middle ground between the peace of God and mental chaos. How could that be our goal? That's an attempt to fixate hallucination, is what it is, obviously. So, I have this capacity to say stuff that others will not say. They will not say it. They just can't. It just, they're too polite. They're too, they bend to profane culture too much, too much. So they're not really Dharma princes. A Dharma prince cannot bend to profane culture. Cannot. They have to tell it like it is. And there's not a lot that are willing to do that. The price seems, too severe to pay. So they kind of try to finesse the whole thing, and it profane culture again spirals into collapse. You have to really turn it around. You just cannot finesse the collapse. Okay, that's not the way to do it. So there's a difference in the way I speak. It's very different. It's got this much more either or, black and white, very adamant, tone. This is the way it is, because it is the way that it is. Right? To say that there's two ways is again the attitude of we can find a way to. Don't worry, we can find a way to fixate hallucination. We just take a little bit of reverence, a little profanity, profane culture, mix them together, and that's the magic elixir that will fixate hallucination, and then we'll all be happy. This is the heart of ignorance, to believe that's possible. The heart of arrogance, really, to believe it's possible. It's not possible. So you cannot compromise on the goal. The goal is the peace of God, period. And the means to get there is right practice, and right practice is supported by a reverent attitude towards yourself and towards others that the elders and the prodigies that are showcasing the success of this practice. That's what works. You don't, when you have something that's the way that works, you don't compromise. It's like an engine. You don't say, well, oil is what works, right? To lubricate an engine. You don't say, well, let's put in half oil and half water. Does that make it better or does it make it worse? It makes it a lot worse. Well, our goal is not to make it a lot worse. Okay, that's not our goal at all. Our goal is success, not failure. And I mean, we have to ultimately drop all evaluation in order to experience reality, where there's all value everywhere, always. So we cannot set a goal of, let's just learn to evaluate properly. You know, let's have some good and some bad. You know, that's not any goal at all. That's failure. Setting your goal is failure. All right? It will fail. Trying to have a wishy-washy compromise goal is failure. Because reality is the way it is. Reality is not some compromise between truth and lies. Not at all. It's not a compromise between no evaluation and evaluation. There's no such thing. There's no place in reality where there's a disproportionate distribution of value. It doesn't exist at all. So there's no way in the world that we can accept, abide in, that we are reality when we still have the habit of evaluation. And if we accept this compromise goal, we're saying, yeah, it's okay to have the habit of evaluation as long as what we're evaluating is real spiritual. That's okay. No, it's not okay, because that's failure. This is a tough for people, tough for us to accept this. Really tough, very tough. Because our continuity fear, our familiarity with doubt, and it keeps saying, no. We just have to find a happy doubt, right? Let's keep evaluation, let's keep doubt, but let's just learn to use evaluation in the right way. That's, you know, that's the very heart of failure, that attitude. Western people are very irreverent to one another, exceedingly so. And it's very distasteful. I mean, I don't care who's reverent to who, as long as there's reverence, a reverent attitude present. But I don't find it anywhere. I think there's only one person I know, young person, that I actually meet with, that tends to have this kind of a reverent attitude, like he actually listens and pays attention to what you say and thanks you, and he notices, like, it's noticeably different, and you say, "Wow, what's that? What's gotten? What is he doing right? What is he doing right?" Well, he wants to be successful, so he listens to those who have some wisdom. He said, "Whatever you got, some wisdom." He says, "You got some wisdom? Pass it on to me, please." I mean, where do you hear a young person say that these days? It almost doesn't exist at all. Can you imagine a young person saying to an elder, "Ah, I could see you've got some wisdom. Please pass it on to me. I'm all ears. Yeah, tell me. Oh, thank you so much for telling me. I'm really going to apply that." You know. Where do you hear that? Where do you hear that? I talk to adults all the time, the elders, and they say no. My son doesn't listen to a thing I say. They know it all, you know. They know Mrs. Google, and she knows it all, right? Yeah, she knows everything, Mrs. Google. And so you, Dad and Mom, you don't know anything. Why should I listen to you? Super irreverent culture, putting your reverence to Mrs. Google. And of course, Mrs. Google is as ignorant as can, all can be. The all technology is a spirit of extreme irreverence, so much reverence. It's like a root canal for them to even acknowledge that religion even exists. They just hate to do it. And they're constantly, you know, you look like the categories, like of all these categories, select something, you know, for how you feel. And it's like, there's nothing religious there at all. Nothing of reverence there at all. Nothing of the sacred. Nothing representing eternal life at all. And then occasionally they squeeze something, and then I realize a year later it's gone again. So they're just chomping at the bit to have a very profane society. And of course, they will be the queens of profanity. They're in the catbird seat, they realize. In a profane culture, technology's in the catbird seat. So, of course, they want a profane culture for their own aggrandizement, which they hope will cure their insecurities. And, of course, it doesn't at all. And you can see some of these bloated tech titans. What a tale that is, huh? I mean, it's the excess. I don't even think they see it. They don't realize what buffoons they are, you know, really. what fools they are, and how people are just kind of, oh my God, they think, look at me, I'm you know, Humpty Dumpty. Yeah, that's what happens. Insecurities are still raging. And of course, if you're young and pulling down, you know, $300,000 a year or something, you know, you might be strutting around. I mean, that just didn't happen when I was young. Young people were not wealthy. Okay, people I grew up with worked hard, and they didn't have money. And if any of them have ever come into money, it's only just through sheer tough, intelligent, industrious work. Okay, my generation. There was no such thing as technology in my generation coming up. There was no easy money at all. It didn't exist. Did not exist. But in this generation, everybody's after easy. All the young people are after easy money. They hope. Right? They're just always scheming. I know. I got retired when I'm 35. I'm going to invent the next great video game. I'm going to invent the next great app. So it's like a gold rush, actually, which, you know, happened in San Francisco, California too. That's interesting. This new gold rush of technology. Everybody all over the world came, I'm going to hit the mother load, and I'm going to get easy wealth. Well, what happened was most of them went broke and destitute, and it was a bad, bad scene. They didn't hit the mother load. It was brutally difficult work. But the ones selling the equipment hit the mother load. The ones selling the clothing to all the prospectors, Levi's hit the mother load. The bankers hit the mother load. The suppliers, all the peripheral people, the suppliers, it's like tech people, you know, the ones who set up these big, you know, websites that enable people to search for riches, they make the riches. Of course, that's always the way, isn't it? Here, yeah, get an internet site, you'll be wealthy. No, you'll be lucky if anybody even looks at it. But everybody wants their .com website, or a whole bunch of them. I used to have a whole bunch of them. Nothing. Ghost town. Most people's internet experience is that of a ghost town. Okay, that's all that it is. A ghost town in a desert. And this is trending that way because of the times we're in right now. But again, you know, it doesn't faze me. I'm not easily fazed. I don't like it that, you know, it's going a ghost town, but, you know, I will keep speaking up and keep, you know, going forward. I realize that, you know, in other lives, one day you're a success, the next day you're a bum. They love you, they love your musical composition, the next one they hate. You're relevant, pretty soon, you're irrelevant. And then later on, irrelevant again. It goes like that. You just have to keep on. As a musician, you know how that works, right? I mean, there's ups and downs. There's ups and downs. And you make a comeback album. You're like, wow. A big comeback album. Elvis and, you know, Memphis album. Suspicious Minds, In the Ghetto. Kentucky Rain. All sorts of songs he had on there. Big hits. Big massive hits. It's a super comeback. I was listening to that last night, the Memphis Sessions with Elvis, comparing him to Dion, his voice, and I realized Elvis was really interesting. He got the most out of what he had. He just had a persona. Elvis was a persona, and a persona that learned how to, the sort of southern way of singing, kind of emotionalized kind of way of singing, he put vibrato, tremolo in his voice. Anyone can do that if they want to do that. It's not so difficult, actually. And so I was listening to it. I said, my God, Elvis is really not that good of a singer, actually. I mean, he's okay. He's very soulful. He's very hip. He's got that southern soul to him. That's a kind of a beautiful, schlocky kind of thing, right? It's kind of kitschy and schlocky, but it's kind of like this sincerity to it. It kind of had that southern sincerity to him. The politeness, the gentlemanliness, all that stuff. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You know, so also so, you know, that southern schlocky sincerity. You know, lots of syrup on everything. Lots of butter and syrup on everything. And hey, you know, this is, you know, we're serving grits here, but man, are these great grits. You know, what a blessing it is to have such wonderful grits, and pour the butter and the syrup on everything, and let's chow down, everyone. Let's enjoy what the Lord has given us. So Elvis sang that way. A lot of butter and syrup in what he was singing. But basically, it's pretty much hominy and grits. A little bit of collard greens and, right? Turnips and, you know, a little bit of pork and sausage and biscuits in there and some gravy. Lots of gravy on. A lot of gravy on his singing, too. But he had great musicians surrounding him. I mean, the Memphis Boys are just, you know, unbelievable geniuses. The Sun Sessions, and Elvis always had really, really great producers, arrangers, musicians that could just lay such a nice groove down. And Elvis knew how to kind of pour the syrup on that groove. And kind of, ah, shucks, you know, and yeah, I'm just a good old Southern boy, and I'm just laying it on. You know, I'm laying it on, but, you know, I'm sincere, and yes, ma'am. And so you bought into it. So people bought into Elvis. They bought into that. And he had his dashing, good Southern looks, you know, like the Southern gentleman, good looks as sort of a dark, handsome man with all the nice manners and mannerisms and stuff. So people bought into the Elvis image. They bought into it, and they became very reverent towards him. Don't be reverent toward musicians either, by the way. Politicians, musicians, forget it. Forget it. And so listening now without that sense of reverence for Elvis, I just, very objective, I just heard it, you know, how Elvis really sings. And I said, oh, that's why it's so easy for all these Elvis impersonators. He's really, you know, it's not difficult to sing like Elvis, actually, which is why there's these hundreds of Elvis impersonators. But you don't see many Dion impersonators or George Jones impersonators. Why? Because they're like insanely great singers. And you can't really sing, then, you know, you can't sound like them. You're going to sound lousy if you try to sound like them. But not Elvis, you know. So many people can sing like, you know, as good or better than Elvis. But they don't have the persona of Elvis, okay? He had that, like I just explained, he had that persona. And he had Colonel Tom Parker selling that persona. And man, did they sell that persona, okay? But inside, Elvis was very insecure, as you could see. You know, he blimped up, drugged out, and died on the toilet, you know, because he was so insecure. Deep down, he said, man, this is all just superficial, you know. I mean, everybody thinks I'm the king, but I'm not the king at all. I don't even know how to deal with my insecurities at all. And he's into the martial arts, you know, and all this, right, and trying to deal with his insecurities by being some black belt and doing all these poses, you know, karate poses and stuff. And getting up there on the stage and, you know, strutting around, sweating around, belting it out. And you know, he tried real hard. He tried real hard to be great, to get rid of his insecurities, but it didn't work. And he tried so hard, he had to, you know, his body was collapsing, and so he had to take all these drugs just to keep him going. And then drugs to take care of the side effects of drugs. That's what the mind does. You know, medication to medicate. The medication of the medication of the medication of the medication of the medication. So he was had this whole shade of drugs, you know, so many. Boom. I mean, it was just heart stopped. His whole system just collapsed. It was horrible. It was a tragedy. Because so many people loved Elvis, really. I mean, he was like, you know, the image of the good South kind of thing. He was like, people said, you know, the South isn't so bad. I mean, there was so much prejudice against the South after the Civil War that, you know, was carried on. There's still tremendous prejudice against the South. You know, it's like the Northerners still think, you know, the conservative Bible Belt Southerners are all a bunch of redneck idiots, you know. It's terrible. They still have terrible prejudice against him. But Elvis was like something that people could love about the South, and the Southerners are very proud of him too. It's like, here's someone that showcases just how talented we really are. We didn't win the war, but culturally we're still superior. Right? Well, they're pretty good musically. Yeah, they are. And the hospitality and music and they've got a lot of grace going on in the South, actually. But again, it's superficial. And so Elvis, being the figurehead for all that, couldn't handle it. It's kind of frightening. Being a figurehead is a very frightening thing. I've been a figurehead in a past life, a cultural figurehead, and I couldn't handle it. I handle it better than most. But I got kind of grumpy about it. Yeah, this is like too tough. It's too difficult. But I did handle it better than most. But it got to me. I mean, it was not easy at all. I didn't really like it. I didn't really like it. I became sort of reclusive, actually. And that habit continued on into this lifetime. I was very reclusive. I've been very, very reclusive this lifetime. I'm a recluse. Yeah, very reclusive. Because I said, I don't want to be a figurehead again, That's too tough. Too tough. So, Longchamp says, maybe you want to be, can you be a figurehead for us to help us out? And I say, wow, I don't know, I'll consider it, but that's a tough thing. You better have the chops, you better realize that you know how to practice right, and nobody is going to tell you different. Otherwise, they're going to chop you down. They're going to chop you down. The ones that are trying to gain reverence, you're going to be their figurehead, and they're going to cheer and cheer, and they think you're like the greatest thing ever, like Elvis. And the ones that don't want to have a profane culture are just going to be hating you and just trying to chop you down, in every which way, mocking in every possible way. I mean, the profane culture is so vicious in how they try to mock. They're pathetic, actually. I don't even pay attention to it anymore. It's just sad. It's too sad. And boring. It's boring. So boring, I don't even want to pay attention to it. Profane culture. So I just don't even pay any attention to it. But that's a skill. It comes from confidence. So you don't want to listen, like maybe there's a grain of truth what they're saying. No, if you really know how to practice right, there's no grain of truth of what they're saying. It's just bitter, envious. Hopeless. They think that they're a hopeless case, and ultimately arrogant, thinking that they'll find a way. They're saying, "We'll find a way to fixate the mind. Don't worry. You're just not smart enough to find the way." No, I'm smart enough to realize there is no way. It's impossible. Okay, I'm smart enough to realize, and humble enough to realize it's impossible. We can't do the impossible. God did not create us to change God. Okay, so we cannot change God. So that means we cannot change what we are. We cannot change reality. It's impossible. So I'm just, moving on down the road, seeing, what my attitude can handle. I'm cautious. It's you get, too much elation on one hand and too much condemnation on the other hand. So if you're gonna be like Elvis, you better be a great singer. A really great singer, and he didn't really have that confidence that he was a great singer. But people idolize him so much, he got away with it. But inside, you see, insecurities were there. Really strong insecurities are there. Michael Jackson, similar problem, right? I don't know why he was so insecure. He was a great dancer and a great singer. But he. Well, singing art doesn't cure us of our insecurities, and he tried really hard to help the world through music cure us of our insecurities, and he couldn't cure himself of his own insecurities, and so he just burned himself out. He burned himself out trying to be greater and greater and greater. So you got to be confident enough where you don't do that. You're gentle with yourself. Say, look, hey, I've got it, so I don't need to put on the Ritz too much, I don't need to burn myself out to try and prove anything to anybody. So, that was sad. I mean, I like Michael Jackson. He was great, great entertainer, great musician, great singer, the whole package. But he wasn't great enough, was he? He wasn't great enough to heal the world. He wanted to heal the world, and a lot of people idolized him, had reverence towards him, and they took it real hard, his fall. But he had a lot of demons because he said, "I just can't get rid of my own insecurities. What's going on?" Well, didn't have reverence towards right spiritual practice at all, right? He didn't have it. Didn't have it. But I know what it's like as a musician. Is you start doing good, you want to do better, and you want to do better, and people get really enthusiastic. It's like, oh my God, maybe this will work. Maybe this will take care of my insecurities, and they're willing to idolize you, hoping that you can do it. They think that if they just applaud you enough, you're going to do it. So they'll be screaming, and chanting, and clapping, and yeah, you can do it. Wow, you're the best thing ever. I look at this stuff on YouTube, and there's some guy, some Latin singer. Latin singers seem to have the most views of some romantic singer or whatever. Over 1.2 billion views. 1.2 billion on Viva. 1.2 billion views. Can you believe it? He's just some singer. I don't even listen. I don't even bother to listen. There's Ricky Martin has almost a billion on some song. So people are like idolizing him, saying, "You can do it for us, Ricky. You can do it. You know, we believe in you." Well, that puts so much pressure on you. You got 1.2 billion people believing that you're it. And deep down inside, you say, "I'm not really it. You know, I'm faking it. I'm trying to be it, but I'm not it." That's horrible. That's horrible. That's terrible. You wonder why musicians commit suicide, you know, which Michael Jackson kind of really did, you know. Propofol, couldn't sleep. He kept taking anesthetics. That's not the way to go. 1.2 billion. So I asked myself, can I even handle 10 views, you know? 10, that's a lot. Can I handle 20, you know, 40, 100? Am I worth 100 views? But 1.2 billion? Oh, man, that's horrible. So you have to really have the right stuff in order to handle a whole bunch of views, you know, a whole bunch of tension, really. You just have to say, well, you know, whatever, I don't... even measure it or think about it. You know, it's just right, just stick with right practice and keep working at it. It's really reverence towards right spiritual practice, not towards me. Okay. It's people deciding to be reverent towards themselves, which is, you know, I applaud them. So I can say, well, I've got a 1.2 billion views for you, you know. Yeah, that's true. I'd give you 1.2 billion views. So it's, you know, it's even. It's even the mutual admiration society here, actually. But again, you know, it's not for the faint of heart. If you want to be a figurehead, that is not for the faint of heart. And only fools, either you're a fool or you're really well prepared to tread into that territory. Nobody else wanders into such a territory. Nobody else goes into that. Barry Bonds could handle it because he was really good. He was at the very top. He knew he was really great at what he did, and he was. So he didn't let anything bother him. Whether people loved him or hated him, he said, "I'm going to be the same person. I don't care." So he would do what he did and say what he said. And now he's living a life of, you know, cycling a lot and doing all sorts of athletic stuff that he loves doing. And he doesn't really care. He says, "Well, I'm getting the Hall of Fame or not, I don't care. I know how good I am." So a bunch of sports writers can't tell me how good I am. They don't know how good I was. What do they know about baseball? Not very much, actually. They didn't play the game. So it's a museum. Why do I care if a bunch of sports writers decide to put a wax bust of me in a museum or something? That doesn't really bother me one way or the other if I don't get in the Hall of Fame. Of course I deserve to be in there. I know I am. I know I'm a Hall of Famer. So the opinions of sports writers don't matter at all to me. That's Barry Bonds, and he's right. He's right. They don't matter. Now, every sports writer who's halfway decent knows that Barry Bonds is a Hall of Famer, without any question. But, you know, they probably won't vote him in. You know, they're trying to be, you know, take a stance, a scapegoat him for an entire era in culture. It was a cultural era, okay? So, you know, we all know that. Those who went through it know it. So stop punishing everybody who went through that cultural era by trying to scapegoat Bonds. You know, put him in the Hall of Fame. Don't stop being stupid. He's a Hall of Famer, period. He knows it, so he, you know, he's okay with it, whatever. I don't care. I know I was good. And so there are people, if you know you're good, you don't really care about people's opinions, praise or censor. You really, it's all the same to you. It's all the same. Praise, wow. Blame, wow. Praise, wow. Blame, wow. Wow, I've already got this perfect medicine from praise. Wow. Wow, I've already got this perfect medicine from blame. Wow. Wow, I've already got this perfect medicine. I already got the perfect medicine from blame. Wow. It's great. Oh, wow, I already got the perfect medicine from praise. Wow. Exactly the same. Exactly the same. I'm always very protective of those figureheads because I know what it's like. I've been through it. And I know how tough it is, so I stand up for him. Nobody knows how tough it is until you've been in that position. No, you just don't know. So, I have a clearer picture of the Dharma, and maybe I was, I don't know, I'm not going to second guess myself, but certainly the interaction with others, those who know right practice, any little interaction, gentle interaction, you know, can be helpful. Just a gentle touch and just say, you know, yeah, I also have reverence for you. And I recognize the guru in you. I recognize the guru in you. That is so important. I recognize the guru in you. That's all what it is. You know, namaste really means I recognize the guru in you. But those who have really got it, you know, it's helpful to really have reverence towards that, because that's having reverence to your potential. You're saying, you know what, I can do it. Let me believe that I can do it. And this is a way of helping me believe that I can do it, even though it seems impossible. I mean, it really can seem virtually impossible. Most of the path seems, it's just every day you think you make progress, and then you say, oh my gosh, there's no way, I just don't see, I can't see it. It's like that. To this morning, I had a rough time. I said, wow, is this impossible? It's just, I can't make it. I just said, no, just, you're in shock still. Let the shock wear off. I'm in shock. So I said, okay, yeah. But it was tough. It was really tough. I started getting angry, and I started feeling defeatist and feeling like I'm not going to make it. I said, no, it's just shock. You're so successful. You're just shocking yourself. So let the shock wear off, and then you'll get your mojo back in. That's what happened. But I faced that every single day. You face doubt every day, thinking, well, I'm still not there. Maybe I'll never get there. So it is not easy at all. So those who have really gone really far in this, you know, this is showcasing, you know, tremendous steady determination, not just bursts of determination, but every day, enormous determination every day. To gather your nerve and your faith and keep believing in yourself, you know. Keep believing that you're going to do it. Not that you can, but that you will do it. You will do it. There's no doubt in my mind, I will do it. And to just stick with that when you seem to be so flattened out, your confidence is so flat. You say, I don't know how I can possibly do it. You have to get to the cross. You have to be crucified every day, and it's a tough walk to the cross every day, so that you can be resurrected into higher confidence, you know, the next day, and then do it all over again. So really, I crucify myself every day. I take the way of the cross, is what Jesus advised us, that he showed us the way of the cross. He dramatized this for us, because drama catches our attention. So he dramatized right spiritual practice for us. And the whole way, the whole passion and the way of sorrows, carrying the cross, and then crucifixion, resurrection, it was just Jesus dramatizing for the world back then. This is how you practice. This is how you have to practice. This is how it's going to be like, as a drama. And ancient peoples really were keen on drama and picked up on drama. They're very, very tuned into that. And so that's how he was able to relay this to them. So follow the way of Jesus, the way of the cross. This is the wow practice. It's you crucify your expectations every day, and you die to what you were every day. I die every day. St. Paul said, I die daily. That's what I do. I die every day, and I'm reborn. I get up the next day, and it's like I'm a different person. I'm reborn. I'm resurrected from the dead as a new person in Christ, as they say, meaning a new set of expectations, a new confidence. And then I go through the whole thing again that day. And then every day, I crucify myself every day. And that's the way. That is the way. Okay? There's no way around it. You have to crucify your expectations every day. You can't just gratify your expectations. That's spirituality. That doesn't ever, ever work. Okay? That's trying to fixate the mind so that the hallucination is permanent, and then we can then imagine that we have a new creation. And guess what? We're the new prime creators. That has no chance of ever working. So the way that works is you must crucify your expectations and do it daily is the best way. I mean, you start out, you might do it occasionally, okay? And you think, wow, that was really something. I don't know if I want to do that again. And slowly you work into it more and more and more and more, and then gradually you start doing it every day. You work into that ultimately throughout the years and decades of practice. And then you may do it more. Crucify yourself even better every day. You make 5 hours, you know, sometimes I do 5 hour videos or close to that, and 3 hour and a 3.5 hours of just really crucifying my expectations very severely, so you can see it, what it's about. But you know that you have to be in really good shape to do that, very confident to do that, because you're really stunned by it, really stunned. And then get in the morning next day, you're still stunned, and you feel like, uh-oh, I don't have my confidence, you know. What's gone wrong? I said, no. And you'll start sliding into anger and bitterness, and I've been tricked. This doesn't really work, you know, and all this stuff comes up, and you have to say, no, be patient. You've been through this before, you know, this is just part of it. And, you know, you're feeling a little bitter and upset because your confidence hasn't come back, and what happened, maybe it won't come back. But it does. It does. It just takes a while. And you have to be very skillful at allowing your confidence to return. You cannot interfere with it. You cannot jump the gun. You just have to be very, very kindly and compassionate and patient with yourself and have a lot of faith and confidence that it will return. And that then it does. And, you know, it's like, wow, now I've really got even more confidence than ever. Similar to working out, where you work out and down the road, you feel the strength. Say, oh my gosh, I'm so much more agile and balanced and strong and flexible than I was before. You make progress. You really feel it. So I crucify myself every day. And that's what Jesus told us to do. He showed us this is the way. And it is the way. It is the way. But it's the same way of other traditions too. Jesus just happened to dramatize it in a certain way for a certain mindset that was really stuck on a certain kind of drama. Sacrifice. Okay. So for those who love the drama of sacrifice, he put on the drama of how to practice in the right way through sacrifice like this through actual crucifixion on the cross and then an actual resurrection, that really hit home for those types of people. But that's not the only way you can present this practice. There are lots of different ways you can introduce it. I haven't literally crucified myself on the cross, right? And literally resurrected where Jesus actually did. Capable of that. He was capable of that level of drama. I'm certainly not capable of that at this point, that is for sure. But he was able to die on the cross and then lay in the tomb and then resurrect the body. Piece of cake for him. Piece of cake. But again, that's not the only way to introduce this practice. There's really any variety of ways really you can introduce it. We're doing it right here, just through these videos. Just a gentle way. There's a gentle way. People are more artistic, cultural, you know, more sophisticated, and not. I'm not really into too much drama, a little bit, but I don't watch opera, for instance. I don't watch TV shows. I don't watch movies. I don't really like much drama. A little bit occasionally. Watching that surfing contest, the last day of that was fun. I enjoyed that. There was some drama there. I used to watch sports. There's drama in sports, a lot of drama in sports. But I'm able to look at it through the eyes of reason, the whole thing. I'm much more into reason and mental clarity and that sort of approach, a Yanni approach, rather than the drama of blood. You know, I'm not into blood at all. I'm not into that, you know, that kind of stuff at all. So that doesn't speak to me so strongly, but I do recognize it, the spiritual genius of Jesus pointing out to everyone that this is how you practice, and I'm dramatizing it for you. But in modern times, Jesus gave a different approach, of course, in miracles. Helped us, move us towards this practice. So, he didn't crucify himself again. He said, I've come back as a friend, relate with you as a friend. So he's not back to be crucified, okay? Not back to be crucified. One time was enough. Now he's calling us to be recognize our own guru-ness, you know, right? He's not lowering himself saying I'm less. He's calling us up to say, you know, I recognize you, the guru in you. When he says I'm here to relate with all of you as friends, that means he's saying you too are just like me. You are the guru of your own practice too. So that's his approach now. So that's my approach now. I have the modern Jesus approach. He's schooled me in his modern approach, which is to recognize the guru in everyone. That doesn't mean, he said, that doesn't mean that you don't have reverence towards me. He says, elder brothers who have done what we need to be done are worthy of your reverence. They're worthy of it. But it's a temporary thing. Ultimately, you'll go even beyond that as you gain full reverence in yourself. You'll still have reverence. You'll have reverence for everyone, but he said it's appropriate for those who temporarily seem to have more. You know, they certainly have more experience and more success. To you have reverence towards them, but not awe. Not awe. He says awe is totally inappropriate to a brother. Only God deserves awe, not Jesus. He said no. I do not deserve any your awe. You have to bring yourself up to my level and realize we're equals. Okay, we're equals. We equally have all value everywhere, always. Right? We're all equals in reality. There can't be anyone having more, because there's all value everywhere, always. How can anyone be more? The idea of moreness in the Son of Godness is impossible. Totally impossible. So Jesus knows this perfectly. And he says, you got to get over this awe thing and bring yourself up. And so I recognize the guru in you, the master in you. You are the capable of bringing yourself to the peace of God, flattening evaluation out, bringing yourself to the peace of God, and recognizing that you are on the level with me, which is all value everywhere, always. We're all that way. We're all that way right now, actually. No one's lower than anyone else. No one's disempowered themselves at all. They're pretending to, out of arrogance, thinking that this will fixate the mind. It's a type of medication for the medication, for the medication, for the medication, for the medication, on and on, that's supposedly supposed to fixate the mind, but it ain't working so well. This, you know, we say, well, yeah, it's working, but it's got all these side effects, like what? Well, like insecurity. Wait a minute, isn't that the main problem that we were treating? We forget about that. We think, no, the medicine we gave it works, but it's got all these side effects. No, it doesn't. It doesn't work. And there's no side effects. It's just insecurity from the very beginning. I didn't touch it. But we gloss that over and say, well, let's not look at that too closely, you know. it's like that. I washed this by hand, and it looks like it cleaned up pretty well. I hope it did. It's just a real thin shell windbreaker. But it's good enough for this evening. It was kind of a nice day in California. The storms have cleared out for now, but we're headed for some more a couple days from now. We just can't get out of the wet, cool weather in California. I mean, it's stretching on for the next 15 days. It looks like, you know, low to mid-60s, cloudy, occasional showers. You know, it's just, it doesn't look very nice, but we had a beautiful day today. It's good enough. It's just, you didn't feel spoiled here. You know, the weather's not spoiling us right now, so we're kind of like grumpy. We understand that's great because it's busting the drought. But we sure wouldn't mind the spoiled weather, to be spoiled again at some point. We're totally used to it being spoiled here by the weather. It's just ridiculous here. Really, you feel guilty about it. The weather's so nice here. It's just, are you kidding me? What, you know, do we really deserve this? I'd say thank you. I said thank you. I mean, wow, it's just amazing atmosphere. Thank you. What an amazing atmosphere. Grateful for it. I have some reverence toward it. I mean, really, I mean, when the atmosphere is just, everything's just so, everything's sparkling, everything's just perfect. Just have some reverence towards that. There's nothing wrong with that. Because in some way it reflects our mind, doesn't it? Everything here is just a reflection of our mind, of our thinking, really. Trying to fixate hallucination, we're still very creative at it, aren't we? And there's still artistry in our creativity of trying to fixate hallucination. Of course there is. Of course nature is full of all sorts of extreme ingenuity and cleverness and artistry in trying to fixate hallucination. So there's nothing wrong with having some reverence to that, but understanding that needs to be turned into right spiritual practice. Don't overdo it. Don't overplay your hand, because make no mistake about it, it is an attempt to fixate hallucination. Hallucinating the absence of reality. Nature is. So don't overdo your nature reference, okay? That needs to be on the back burner. I mean, I enjoy, you know, a good sunset, and, you know, nature's really, really beautiful. I say, yeah, that's beautiful. I enjoy it. I'm not a killjoy in that regard, but don't overdo it. Don't overplay your hand. That's for sure. You know, it's like if you've got, you're really fit, you know, don't flaunt your body. Don't flaunt it. Don't flaunt our cleverness and ingenuity and artistry of trying to fixate the mind. Don't flaunt it. We don't have to demonize it. Just don't flaunt it. You know, don't be profane about it. Don't be profane. Don't live a profane life. Don't flaunt arrogance. You know, the cleverness at being arrogant. Don't flaunt it. Yeah, again, sure, it's a faint echo of our creativity, and it, you know, points to that a little bit, faintly. But, you know, it's a crumb. Don't flaunt crumbs. You know, you're still in a crummy situation, right? With all this bias and habit, you're in a very crummy situation. So take it seriously. Don't be around flaunting, like, hey, don't flaunt your crumbs, profane crumbs, just because there's some, you know, creativity to them. or ingenuity, cleverness, it's not going to get you anywhere. Keep the body covered up, okay? Don't try to look, you know, too good. And just be humble, modest. Like that. That's the right culture. It's called conservative culture instead of profane culture. Conservative culture means, hey, you know, cover up. Yeah, you're profane. Don't brag about it, okay? Don't brag about how profane you are. That is so, so irreverent. So irreverent, right? Yeah, those who are reverent, they're still profane, but they're trending in the right direction, okay? Where those who are profane, they take the path of flaunting their profaneness, are trending in the wrong direction. So there is a big difference between profane and reverent culture. And those in profane culture keep mocking, you know, social conservatives with their, you know, moral values and conservatism about, you know, don't brag about how, you know, your profaneness. They're just mocking it, mocking it, mocking it. What is that? They're going in the wrong direction. Who are they to mock? The fool's mocking is really pathetic. So conservative culture means don't brag about how profane you are. Yeah, we get it. You're a sinner. You're profane. Stop bragging about it, and let's get down to work of practicing being reverent towards spiritual truth. Be reverent towards Jesus. Be reverent towards the practice that he's shown us. Be reverent to the Dharma kings, whatever tradition you are. Be reverent to it. That doesn't mean you're perfect. Never said perfect. You know, Christians say we're sinners. We're not saying we're perfect, but those who are profane and want to brag about how profane they are, they keep thinking like they've got something to mock them about. No, they don't have anything to mock them about. They set up a straw man, like, oh, you think you're so perfect, and look, you're not perfect. Look, you're profane too. And so we say, so what? We never said we're not profane. We're sinners, but we're trending in the right direction to deal with this, and yet you're bragging about it, you're not even dealing with it at all. What is that? So it's absurd is what it is. So profane culture has got nowhere to go except collapse. So let it collapse, all right? Let us pay attention to trending towards genuine reverence, towards right practice, which is where what we should be reverent to, and being the gurus of our own spiritual practice and being reverent towards ourselves and our capability to practice in the right way. That and don't brag about being profane. You know, don't go around cussing. You know, that is so stupid, right? And if you do, if you happen to let out a cuss word, apologize about it and say, I'm sorry, you know, that some profanity slipped out. That's profanity. It's being profane. You know, you know, we just so accepting all this stuff and we're cheering it on. That, you know, that is so boring, okay? Absurdity is just boring. That's all it is. There's nothing there. It's just going towards collapse, and collapse is boring. Doesn't get anywhere, does it? Except mental illness, actually. So profane culture no matter what race you are, no matter what gender you are, no matter what age you are, no matter what demographic you are. Bragging about profanity, being profane, is profane culture, and it's boring. Okay? It's boring. I don't care if you're some special group of, you know, if you're gay, or if you're a feminist, or if you're transgender, or if you're black, or if you're white, or, you know, yellow, red, straight, whatever you are, man, sexist, whatever you want to call. It doesn't matter. You know, all these terms don't matter. If you're part of profane culture, you're part of profane culture. That's all there is to it. And it's boring. It's totally boring. And it's not worth our attention. It's not worth anyone's attention. So don't expect our attention, because you're not going to get it. You're not going to get it. And we're turning our attention to what deserves reverence, which is ultimately ourselves in right spiritual practice towards the peace of God, where it's the final condition that we experience before we once again accept eternal life, which is all value everywhere always, and are able to function in that and accept it, and doesn't freak us out at all. Okay, that's the goal for all of us, period. There is no other goal. Okay, a dead end is not a goal. Okay, profane culture dead ends. Okay, it collapses into a dead end. That is not a goal. It's futility. Okay, it's the evidence of futility of trying to do the impossible. That's all it is. It's not a goal. It doesn't deserve any attention. So, you know, we're getting some of this out here, bit by bit by bit. We're getting it out into the consciousness, collective consciousness of the planet. Thank you for watching this. Bit by bit, right? We're turning it around here. We're turning it around. We have a voice here that's helping turn it around, saying what needs to be said. And this is beyond spirituality. Okay, this is the real deal. This is not spirituality. Okay, this is right practice. This is the real deal. And so the verbiage, the way we present it, is different than spirituality. I'm not trying to present spirituality here. So people might say, well, that's not very spiritual. The profane will say, oh, that's not very spiritual. Well, the profane love spirituality because they know they can mock it properly, right? It's mockable for them. Okay, this here, it's not mockable, really. Yes, right? We don't even care what they say. It's boring. So they might say, well, haha, it's not spiritual. Your way you're presenting is not spiritual. Yeah, of course it's not spirituality. It's not spirituality. We're not presenting spirituality. We're presenting reverence for eternal life and the way to eternal life here. And that's it. Because we know there is a way. Okay, we know there is a way. The Dharma Kings have assured me of this. I've practiced enough that I've glimpsed it. I've glimpsed it and I've seen, yeah, what they're telling me is true. What they're saying is true. And they've told me for sure this is what works and you will succeed for sure. So they've given me assurances. I trust in their assurances. I've seen, reason has seen why it works. So I say, you know, I trust you. I know this works, so I'm willing to stick my neck out a little bit here and turn things around, help turn things around. How are we doing here? The great 2-hour mark. Maybe no one's listening because it's 2 hours, but, you know, this is so important. I cannot give it short shrift here, and it's so difficult to say this. I need to build up to it, you know, and maybe, you know, who knows, I can't shortchange you. I can't shortchange myself. I have to really give a very clear, justifiable explanation about all this. It has to be, you know, very much there for you, so you can say, hey, you know what? This really feels valid. In my gut, I really feel it. That's what's vitally important. So, you know, take your life with reverence. You have reverence for your life, your capacity to do right practice. You're capable of it. Anyone is. So have reverence for that. And start saying, hey, you know what? I can do something that is totally important and reverent. And I can start really having confidence in myself and realizing I'm a guru. You know, I'm a guru of my own path. I can be the guru of my own path. I can be ultimately successful. I can have the peace of God. I can be one of the saints. I can be one of, you know, you go down as one of them and help out everyone. I can do this. Because you can. You can. You absolutely can. Ah. Okay, hold on. Let's try this again. Listen. Yes, son. Hello? Yeah, I'm. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Yes. Yes. Sure. Bring it on home. Thank you. Yeah. Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. Take care. Bye. Love you. Bye. Okay. well, there goes my diet. Yeah, they said, can we bring you home a hamburger, a veggie burger? I said, ah, yeah, sure, you know. I just have to eat like half of it. Of course, that's difficult to do. Now, they keep busting my diet, you know. What's going on? Last time it was pizza. Now this time, they say, you know, hey, we're worried you're getting too thin. I said, no, I'm not too thin. I'm getting agile. Maybe they don't want to be so agile and confident. But, you know, I am working out a lot. I don't want to get too light. I start getting weak if I get too light. It's a fine line between thin and agile and too light and weak. It's a fine line. So I'm kind of walking that line right now. But I'm getting stronger, you know. I don't know how far I'll hit the golf ball. I don't know. Whatever it is, it is. But I am certainly getting stronger overall. And when I swing a club now, I can feel, you know, there's more power in the swing. It's true. There's more power. You got to sweet spot it too. Launch it right and spin and everything. It's got to be right. Right ball, right club, everything to get the distance. But, you know, the swing is getting more powerful. So, you know, I keep working on it. It'll get better and better and better, really. Up to a point. And then after that, you're building in stamina. And it's probably, you know, there's a limit somewhere. You would think, right? Somewhat of a limit. Just the overall leverage I can apply. But maybe you could do it, you know, a lot of times in a row and you wouldn't feel so bad and wiped out and hurt and tired from swinging so hard. I try not to swing too hard, actually. Try to be gentle power with the swing. Have gentle power with the swing. That's my focus right now, my mantra. Gentle power, not wild, all-out, brutal power, but gentle power. It's like Aikido or something, Jiu-Jitsu, Aikido or whatever. You know, the opponent comes at you and, you know, just gently, just lay him down gently. It's just all gentle. They're on the ground, but it was done very gently. Very gently. No violence in it. You know, so don't have a violent swing, golf swing. Have a gentle power swing. So that's what I'm doing, gentle power. Take it back nice and slow and gentle, and then before you know it, transitions like, oh, you finished the swing. What happened? I didn't even see it. Yeah. Well, that was gentle. Whew, there goes the ball. Like, oh, it's a rocket. Nice, gentle rocket. I like that. I play with some guys who like that. I watch their swing. They didn't look like they were violent swing at all. I said, ha, it's a gentle swing. But they went back slow. Nice and easy. They started to come down. And then at some point, they went from here to there, like, so fast, it was just like, I could hardly see it. So they load up, and just through the impact zone, that's where they're super quick through there. But the rest of the swing, it seems nice and balanced and gentle. You know, that's the real key to it, is just be really fast through the impact zone. But the rest of the swing should not be violent. It should be nice and relaxed, like, you know, I'm not really trying too hard. Nice and gentle. Nice and gentle. But super quick through the impact zone. That's the whole key to it. That's how the pros swing. That's why you shake your head and say, how are they doing that? Because you're looking for this real brutal, violent swing, and it's not there. And you say, well, I swing harder than they do. Yeah, you might swing harder than they do, but you're not as fast through the impact zone as they are. See, that's our frustration. Most golfers are very frustrated about the pros. They say, man, I don't understand it. I spring fast back and I just caveman it through and just crush it. I want to crush that ball. And it goes like 220. What? The pros are just kind of relaxed and just kind of, okay, just nice and slow through there and click. And you know, they're there now, it's finished. It goes 340. Say, what? You're kidding me. It seems like it's impossible. I think there's some trick they're doing or something. We can't figure it out. But it's speed through the impact zone. Whereas they just leveraged their whole swing. Everything is leveraged for a sudden, quick speed through the impact zone. And then after that, you know, it's nice and smooth and gentle to the finish. It seems that way. Their balance is so good, they make it look like it's just done easy and gently and smoothly. But if you don't have the core and the balance, it's going to look more violent and aggressive, the swing. You're going to be thrown off balance and you're discombobulated. It's like, wow, that really swung hard that time. Whereas the pros have even more speed, but it's just a nice silky smooth finish, like, oh yeah. But they're on the edges of their feet and toes, and their body is torqued, and they're out there like that. It's John Florence torquing his body on these layback cutbacks into the barrel. You know, you just, like, it looks easy, and then they slow motion it. And you can't believe it, what he's doing. It's just like, he's like laid back, like his back's almost on the wave. The way it's torquing his body and his core and everything, it is just like, you just say, oh my gosh, he's like upside down. There's one picture of him right now. He's upside down on the lip, and he made that. You know, it's like, he made it. It says, are you kidding me? It's like a cat, super cat surfing. Maybe that should be his nickname, is Super Cat. He's Super Cat. Come on. And he makes it look so easy, like, oh yeah, I could do that. Maybe not. He made the other surfers look like there were kooks out there. He really did. He got the best surfers in the world. And like in the final, Kaloi Andino, and he looked like a kook surfing those waves. It was ridiculous. And he's trying to, you know, surf them as best as he can. And he looked like he didn't know what he was doing. Like he looked like you or me out there surfing, you know, bouncing around, kind of struggling, his guy's crouching down, his weight, legs too wide, squatting too much, getting by the white water section. He's like, oh, how do I gonna know if I can make this? He's like nervous and everything. And John's out there, he's like zipping around. Like, oh, this is fun, you know, wow, this is great. I'm so much fun, easy. And they, all the great surfers said, no, those waves are super difficult to surf. Really, you don't see the ribs and the cuts on all of them. And it's just so difficult to do what he did, to make it look easy. He said, how did he do that? But he did. That's like a pro golfer. They just make it look so easy. Rory McIlroy hitting it 420, you know. I saw a video of him hitting it 420. I said, how did he do? So he's like, nice, easy swing. Right there. Oh, yeah, so just, you know, there. I said, oh, just a lazy swing by Rory. He goes 420. How did he do that? Nobody knows. But, you know, the tape tells the tale. I mean, he just knows how to torque it through that impact zone and sweet spot it. But just, man, I mean, I don't know what swing speed was. It must have been 135 or something. But it didn't look like anything. You actually, on slow-mo, you couldn't even see him hit the club go through the impact zone. He's going like this whole swing like this. Okay, it's going like this, it's going like this. And then suddenly, the next frame, his club's way over here, you know. It went that fast that in slow-mo, you can't slow it down enough to see it go through the impact zone. It goes through that fast. It's 6 inches before the impact zone, and one frame the next, it's 6 inches past. So it really speeds up right through that impact zone in an amazing way. So I have to work on that. That's the entire secret to it all. That's the pro secret. That is the pro's secret right there. And if you learn how to do that, yeah, you'll hit it like a pro too, actually. You will. So when you learn the secrets like to this wow practice and you learn them and you get it and you really get good at it, then you're good at it. That's how you do, you know, you're practicing like a pro. You're crucifying yourself very, very successfully. Crucifying your expectations to an extraordinary extent. All our mental habits are build up expectations that we're going to think in this way. We're going to use our mind in this way. We expect to use our mind in this way. And suddenly we're using it in a different way. Like, wow, I've already got, you know, this perfect medication from this pain. Wow, I've already got the perfect medication from this pleasure. Wow, I've already got the perfect medication from this suffering, from this failure. Wow, you know, wow, I've already got this perfect medication from this success. Wow, this is using the mind in a totally different way than we're used to using it. And we do not expect to ever use it in this way. It is totally unexpected. So it's like just crucifies your expectations by doing this. It really does. Knocks you out, puts you into shock. The death of practice, the crucifixion of right practice. Go into shock, practice patient non-action, and then you bounce back after a while, after a day or so, or a little sooner sometimes, and you feel more confident than ever, and then you practice even better. That's it. That's it. So the heat pad is no longer warm, and it's getting late. It's already 8:30 out here, and so that's probably enough video for now. And I've crucified myself plenty now, and I have to then. What I'm gonna do? I'm gonna eat that burger. The burger's on the way. I haven't had a burger in years. I really haven't. Last time I had a burger, well, almost 2 years actually, August of 2015. I went through the summer of pigging out, being profane, and eating. I knew it was my last gasp at being profane, because I knew if I didn't get with it starting September 1st, 2015, I would never get with it. I would slip into profane culture and become very profane myself. So, I in the back of my mind, I said, "Well, if I am going to do it, and help turn profane culture around, to help us turn towards reverent culture, I'd have to start." And so it was last call for me, and I said, well, let me just be profane with my eating. So I was totally profane with my eating. I still eat veggie burgers. I didn't eat meat, but you know, big awesome double patty veggie burger with everything imagined possible. It was like, it was so high you couldn't even get your mouth around it, you know. It was just crazy burgers. And then after that, all the ice cream, three different flavors, whipped cream, the nuts, chocolate cake with that. That was every day. I just eat whatever, you know, hot dogs, veggie hot dogs, just eat three of them with all the fixings. And then the massive dessert. I just pigged out on anything I wanted to pig out on. And yeah, Snickers bars, candy, whatever, as much candy as I wanted. And just down until I couldn't eat anymore. I just eat candy until I couldn't eat anymore. Eat ice cream until I couldn't eat anymore. So I was just a complete pig up to September 1st, and poof, that's it. Then I stopped. Smoothies. Stop, you know, and cut out all sweets, all hamburgers, hot dogs, all that stuff. And that's when that diet started, September 1st. Full blast, 2:15. And haven't stopped for a single day since then. Haven't stopped. Still goes on. And then my workout started later on, more like November, I think, of 2:15. Kind of started working out then. That took a little more doing. You know, that's a little more difficult to commit to that, because then it's got sore muscles. You know, I'd rather starve than have your body all sore from working out. That's a pain. Because I'm used to dieting, and I've done it so many times, it's just not so difficult. Once you get over the first couple of days of not eating so much, and your stomach shrinks, then it's pretty easy. It just takes discipline. But working out, you're always going to suffer. You know, I'm still suffering. Because every day, you know, you do more, you push yourself, and so you never feel. I never feel very good physically in terms of. I feel sore. I feel tired. But overall, the trend is better and better and better and better. But so working out is tougher than dieting. And dieting is tough. Sure it is. It's, you know, especially if you start eating again, you say, hey, this is fun. And like, pizza like is the worst, right? Pizza's fun. Good pizza is like, wow, I think I'll have one more piece. And then after you finish that one, you say, I think I'll have one more, just one more. And then after that, you think, one more. And then you say, heck, I'm almost done. I might as well finish. And then you've eaten like, you know, too much. All right, well, we end we're in our cool down phase now. Okay, so we've crucified ourselves. Okay, we're now in the tomb. Now in the tomb, and we're kind of relaxing in the tomb, right? Nothing of consequence now. We're not talking about anything of consequence right now. Chit-chatting about burgers. I got to eat a burger. Wow. What am I going to eat with it? Fries? I'll probably bring fries too. Wow, that's not good. No. I'm hammering the kale smoothies here. So yeah, we're in the tomb now. We're in the tomb. We're in the tomb. We're in the tomb. People think we're dead. We're not really dead. We're just in a state of shock. Signifies death of the old identity, expectation-driven identity. And so we're in shock. We're in the tomb. We're taking it easy. And after a while, we'll feel good enough to roll the stone away and come back out of the tomb. And I say, yeah, I feel fine. And people look at you and say, oh, man, you're looking good today. Like that. They can tell, oh, you're looking good. And they don't worry about you. But so don't let them see you in the tomb too much, because they're kind of like, are you okay? You don't look okay. You tired? Did you get some sleep last night? Yeah. They start worrying and doubting of you. You don't need that. So keep a low profile. Fly under the radar. With this practice, you really need to fly under the radar, okay? Which I have done as far as socially goes. I share this part of my Dharmic commitment, these videos, but socially I fly under the radar totally. That's the problem. If you're a figurehead, everybody wants you to like be like really great all the time. And if you don't, oh my gosh, there's something wrong. You know, maybe they're not a figurehead. I should doubt them. You know, that this is a problem, right? And so if you're a figurehead, you always want to be, you know, oh, I'm never in shock. I'm never dying to what I am. I'm never in the tomb. I'm never on the cross. Never struggling. And, you know, so, and that then you stall out on your path. You stall out. You stall out. It's a stall out. But it's hard to have, for people to have faith in those who appear to be, you know, in shock, and then in the tomb of this laying low, like I've got the blahs. I don't feel so good. You know, if you're like a trainer, you know, for athletes, and you're like limping around, but people kind of look and say, "What's that? A very good trainer? What's the matter with them?" Well, I worked out for 5 hours yesterday. Like, you mean you're sore and suffering? Really? Oh, yeah. I don't want that. I thought you were going to train me not to be sore and suffering. No, I'm going to train you to be sore and suffering and how to put up with it. That's what I'm going to train you. Or I'm training you to crucify yourself. And then how to deal with that and how to put up with it properly and then do it again tomorrow. I'm not training you to not suffer. Training you how to suffer right in the right way, how to suffer, how to take the path of the cross is what I'm training you in here. So, yeah, get that. So you have to fly under the radar too. Learn how to fly under the radar. The way of the cross. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus Christ. This Easter week, which is all about the way of the cross, isn't it? So Jesus is helping give out this information during Easter week. It's his gift to us for this Easter. I always complain to Jesus, he never does anything for Easter. So finally, I guess he backloaded it and gave us this incredible treasure for the Easter of 217. Very memorable and historic time, actually, because of what's going on here. This information coming to light and being presented in this way. It's Jesus' gift to all of us, you know. And he's back, folks. Jesus is back. Just keep hearing this. He is back. He is back. I've met with him, not physically, spiritually. He is back. And that's why this information now is being made so clear, and we're accelerating this information out. I'm working with him. He contacted me and said, you know, okay, this is how we're going now. We're gonna go this way. And I said, okay, let's give it a try. And so, you know, this information is super important, super relevant, and it's Easter week. Perfect timing by Jesus, right? Perfect timing to give this information out. And it's strong information. But, you know, he means business. You know, he's here to turn it around. He's here to turn us towards a reverent culture, reverence, back to reverence, okay? How to be reverent. We need to make that turnaround right now, in your attitude, right now. Just say, I've chosen to go towards a reverent culture of reverence, okay? And that's it. And the other now is boring to me. Just like on September 1st, August 31st, I decided September 1st, I'm dieting. I'm done with my profane eating. It's finished. It was a tough decision, but I was do or die, and I said, okay, I'm in. And that's it. Haven't gone back since. So it's a tough decision, but when you make it, you feel so good about yourself. You said, yeah, the other is boring. Profane culture is so boring. I'm done with it. I'm not going to put my attention on it anymore. I'm done. And then you start having reverence for yourself. You start feeling reverence for yourself. You say, hey, that's kind of a guru-ish decision, isn't it? That's an awesome decision. I must be something of consequence. My spirit must be really something to make that decision. And you start having reverence for yourself, which is really the goal, isn't it? Yes, it is. So make that decision right now. You're going to turn away from profane culture. You've had enough. You have had enough. That's it. Now you're trending and your life is trending towards reverent culture. You're going to have a feeling of reverence and you're going to carry that attitude. You're going to have a reverent attitude. Okay? Plain and simple. Plain and simple. Very easy. Very cut and dried. Plain and simple. And also quite shocking. When you first do it, it's like, oh my gosh, I just shocked myself. I didn't know I could do this. So, be shocked. You just crucified yourself, right? You just did something you didn't expect you could do at all. You crucified your expectations. So now, die on the cross. Let yourself die into shock so that you now carry yourself into the tomb. Be laid in the tomb. And let yourself recover from the crucifixion. It's that simple. So I'm giving this out to the loyal YouTube viewers, okay? Not to Facebook, the Johnny Come Latelys. They didn't have a reverent kind of feeling at all towards this. I wasn't allowed to present this on Facebook. Dharma Kings wouldn't allow me to present. It was way too profane a place to do that. Way too profane a place at this point. Now, maybe later on I may, you know, who knows what my relationship with Facebook will be. But at this point, no, they don't deserve it. It's way too profane a place. But for you who have been watching these videos, you know, you may be able to hear this in the right way and take it in the right way. We can expect something along those lines, and whether it happens or not, we still expect it. We have a reverent attitude towards your capability. Absolutely we do. We have confidence. We have faith in you. We have faith in you because we know what you really are. And you just because you hallucinate the absence of what you really are doesn't mean you're not what you really are. You still are that. So there we go. We reached the we reached the 2:30 mark. That's good. And maybe I should work out some more for that burger. You know, I'm gonna have to pay my dues if I eat a burger. I'm gonna have to pay the price, which means more workout tomorrow. Oh man, I hope I don't feel really sore tomorrow because sometimes the second day you feel it. But right now I'm still feeling pretty bouncy, which is great. Feeling pretty bouncy. Able to, get up off a seat pretty nicely. And, but hey, it's not easy right now, is it? Profane culture's got a lot of people down. It's really got them down. Okay, so I want to showcase to you, I'm not down. Okay, I'm not down. I don't pay attention to it. Okay, so I am not down. Not at all. I'm bouncing around like I feel great. I'm not sinking into some bog. Okay, bog of despair? I absolutely not. I'm on fire most of the time. I'm able to crucify myself every day in Christ, okay, and be resurrected every the next day. So, I'm not falling down, folks. Okay, just feel that, and you don't have to fall down either. You just make that decision. You say that's okay, that's it. Maybe by May 22nd, that's a cut. It's a really drop-dead date. You have to make that decision by May 22nd. You just have to. Okay, put that in your mind. I got to make that decision that profane culture is out and reverent culture is in. And it's just 100% thing. That's all there is to it. When I went on that diet, the ice cream was out. Period. Cake was out. Sweets, they were out. Not I cut back on them. They were totally out, and they haven't come back in. They're out. You got to make some. You have to set some parameters for yourself. Okay? Profane culture is just out. The key elements, obviously living in this world, it's so profane that you have to live in a cave, try to get away from it, actually. But there's for the most part, you know what I'm talking about. You just simply cut all that stuff out, okay? And you don't pay any attention to it anymore. It's so boring, you just can't take it anymore. And you decided that's it. That's it. What a great feeling that is. What a great feeling that is. What a great feeling. You know what? Self-respect. You feel reverence for yourself. You feel reverence for yourself. Right away, you feel it. What a great feeling that is. And then you start having an idea of how I feel, and a little idea of how the Dharma kings feel, right? Just a little inkling. You start getting a little inkling like, hey, so yeah, wow. Yeah. All right, very great. That'll be it for this one. Wow. Wow, I already have perfect medicine from this video. Wow.